Well, folks, I got this CK today. Bought it for less than scrap prices, actually. And it is really in rough shape. I mean, as you can see, it really is in rough shape. And to add to this condition, it has rust in the bottom of the cabinet. So it's rough. But I'm going to see what kind of condition it's in, see if the compressor will run, and take it from there. Chances are it would be a good, refrigerating machine to restore and use on a better cabinet. But I don't know what I'm going to do. But again, I just messed up and bought it. So there you go. So the first order of business is going to be to unwrap this abomination and see what we got going on in here. Looks like devil horns, and that's probably exactly what we're going to find. There was the remains of a cord tied in here that I cut off. It was so badly rotten that you could literally see the electricity going by. Yeah, I didn't even see any need to waste the time having that dangling and getting in the way while we were trying to load it, so I snipped that off. I was able to check that the motor has continuity, and it did actually have about 8 ohms of resistance, so there's hope that it's the motor might run. We'll see what goes on. I'm going to have to man up and hook it up and plug it in, so that may happen after a while today. Next thing is going to be the charging port. I already tried by hand, it wouldn't come off. Not as horrible as I expected. But that's a good thing. Okay, so with no rehearsal of any sort whatsoever, I'm fixing to hit the switch. Sounds like it's running. Doesn't sound very healthy. Well, at least I know the compressor runs. I don't feel any heat at all. Oh no. Well, I smell it. That's not good. I didn't smell any until I tried to run it. Oh boy. Well, now the leak searching begins. So, well, you know, whenever this top is flipped around the wrong way, that tells you somebody had it off. And when I got to the seller's place, it was actually not even sitting on the cabinet correctly. So, apparently, it got roughed up a little bit. And looking down here, you can see that line is bent back out of the way and kind of scratched up. Yeah. Okay. Well, this is going to be another day's project. Yep, same exact place that Andrews had the problem. And I guess it had leaked out so long ago that there wasn't any SO2 to smell earlier, but then after running that short time, I guess it drew some air back in through the broken line, and now the pressure's escaping. The air that it drew in is escaping with SO2 residue. So that is kind of what I expected, but you know, then again, when you make a save of something that was in this condition, you just expect that kind of thing. But I don't want anybody to feel bad for me or bad for this machine, because the fact that the compressor runs, it can be fixed. and I will take it off the cabinet and I'll clean up that area and resolder it and evacuate it and charge it, and we'll see how it sounds and runs with some refrigerant in it. Probably won't be today or tomorrow, but it will happen. Thanks for watching. Okay, this top assembly is off of the CK that I brought home yesterday, the very wounded CK, and I'm going to try to fix this line. There's a macro close-up shot where you can see impact damage on there, and it's broken the solder bond below it, and this is crushed back in against the header. So following the line back, follow it around here, that looks like it's rubbed on concrete. So clearly this unit was taken off and rough handled, and the result was this line got hit right in here. So the first thing I'm going to do is try to bend this line back in position correctly and get everything straightened out and make sure no other places break in it or look like they're weakened. And then once that's done, I'll go ahead and try and actually get this out of here where I can work with it. Again, you can see how this is bent right in this area, so I'm going to try to bend it back to make it straight again, because I know that when GE designed it, it would have looked somewhat neat and tidy in the design back here. Just trying to find all the spots where it's been impacted and straighten it out. That up there needs to be straightened back out again. And again, that area that I just pointed out right in here, I'm going to try to get that line out of there totally. And that way I can clean it up. But in the meantime, I'm just going to get in there with something kind of soft, like this old plier handle. Get that straightened back out. Need to get a thinner tool to do that. Got a variety of different things here that might work. I know I'm probably blocking the view, but it's gonna have to happen like that this time. Because my goal is not to put tool marks on it with metal tools. So it may look like I'm doing it the hard way, but the reason is I don't want to bend up or scratch up the line and put nicks in it. Because when you nick up something made of metal like that, that causes a stress riser, and that can cause it to start cracking right there. And obviously, we don't want that to happen. Looking better. I think I can live with that. So now that line's more or less in its normal position, I'm going to come with the Dremel tool and a little wire wheel brush and try to clean up around it. One thing, it won't solder if it's dirty. So that looks better. I've also got the smaller brush if I've got to get down there behind it. You can kind of get a view of the crack under the solder, right underneath there, where it's not bonded to the stainless steel anymore. That's where the leak was. Now I need to get that out of there completely before I try to resolder it. Because even though I've taken precautions of evacuating it first and then putting inert gas in there, there's still a chance there could be oil trapped in this, so I don't want to just try to melt that out. I'm going to try to get it out of there using a mechanical means if I can. And if I can't and I have to melt it out, for safety's sake, I'm going to cut this line back here somewhere to make sure there's no way there's trap pressure. But I'm going to first try to get to study what tools I have available and try to get that pulled out of there. Well, I can't get that out, so I got no choice but to cut it right down here. Again, I hate to do this, but it's just too risky to try and heat that solder and melt it, because you know it's that tubing is a press fit into there and there could still be pressure. You know, I don't want to take a risk of having it blow a bunch of boiling hot oil or possibly flaming oil when I open it up. So I'm just going to cut it down here. And I made sure I had room to work right here to resolder it too. There we go. Now, even if I have to melt that out, I'm not going to be taking that big of a risk. And protect that. Hopefully that'll fit. I wish I had one size bigger. There we go. Now I can safely work on this part. So I've got the Burns-O-Matic torch here. Not wanting to come out of there. Well, that little torch, it wouldn't do it. I was getting too much heat up in this area, and I'm going to use the oxyacetylene torch to actually make another attempt at getting that out of there. More concentrated heat, and I should be able to heat up just that solder joint without heating up the rest of the evaporator. At least that's the theory. Yeah, it melted. Come on. There we go. That must be a very, like a high silver alloy that they used at the factory, because that took a lot of heat to melt. Now, I don't know how well it's going to show up on the video, but if you look at this port, you see there's solder stuck to the evaporator around this part. Then over here there's none. You can see the stainless steel is clean all the way down in there. That's where it was debonded. So that was the leak point. Now I got to clean that up, get all that off of there, and go back with fresh solder. All right, I got it cleaned up. I used the Dremel again and used this tool on low speed to clean as much as I could of the original solder off of there. And then I took this over to the wire brush and deburred it and got it all ready to go. And it'll sit in there like that and line right up with its original, or line right up with its other end point right down here. So once I get the coupler for this, I'll be able to solder that back together. But in the meantime, I'm going to try to go ahead and do this solder joint up here, since this is the tough one. Soldering copper to copper is very, very easy, but soldering the copper into the stainless, sometimes it takes more than one shot. And if I were really proficient at it, I could always do it on the first try like the professionals can. But this is something I only do every now and again, so sometimes it's not a sure shot. So I put that little clothespin clamp just to keep it from falling off of that other line if I bump it. because I don't want to have to be messing with that while I'm trying to solder it. Obviously, it needs to stay in the right position. And then this is the solder that everybody on the Monitor Top forum recommended. This is the Stay Bright 6 alloy. And then this is the flux for it, the liquid acid flux. So what I'm going to try to do is put the flux on there, and the solder will follow that flux, so you don't want to get the flux where you don't want solder. And I'm going to try very carefully just to brush some right on the inside rim of that hole and right around it. And the same thing goes for this tubing. I don't want a bunch of flux down inside the evaporator, because it'll make it all too easy for the solder to follow it, flow down in there, and possibly plug up something. So just going to brush around what I've got on the brush. I'm not going to put a whole bunch. And then get ready with the torch. Now this doxyacetylene torch, it looks like a small flame, but it has a tremendous amount of heat energy to it. So I'll just have to start heating it carefully, and it won't take just a second and the solder will start flowing. It's very, very easy to overheat it. It just puts a terrific amount of heat in a short amount of time. And that might be good. I'm going to try to put a little more flux around it. Help the solder spread out some. Because what I don't want is for that solder to fall down inside there and plug up the end of that line, where then I got nothing. So let that cool off, and then take a little closer look at it. Okay, now that that is cooled off, I'm going to hit it with the wire brush a little bit and try to kind of burnish it. Get a closer look at it now. Okay, I've got it focused in macro mode, and I don't like it. Right there is a pinhole, so I'm gonna have to get the torch back out and reheat that spot and try to get that to blend in a little bit, and then close up that pinhole. Well, I turned it upside down so that the float would stay open. Got the vacuum pump going on it. So I'm going to take a lunch break and come back and then see if it holds. Well, I jumped forward in the repair process a little bit in the video, because when I got back from lunch, the rain was pouring down, and you can't hear anything in this metal building when it's raining. So I went ahead and rewired it. Changed all the wiring inside while I had the opportunity with the evaporator loose. Put in the second cord for the cabinet light, but I don't have a connector for yet. And I didn't put the control back in place because of the missing knob. And I don't know what kind of damage has been done inside there. So later I'm going to take this apart if I can and see if it's going to be salvageable or not. I know I won't be able to get another knob for it, but might be some good parts in there. So, going to charge this up and see if it cools. There's nothing left to do but that, so I'm going to get on with it. Okay, so the moment of truth is coming. It has three cans of R152A in it, all hooked up and fixing to hit the switch. And this is, of course, the high side only. I don't have a low side port. That's getting warm. That's encouraging. It's more than it did yesterday. It's a different noise. Evaporator's getting cold. Run at about 175 PSI on the high side. Notice the load on the motor is going down. That's encouraging. I'm going to let it run a minute, take the camera off the tripod, and get some close-ups of it. Motor current. I'm going to change to actual power. That's the motor power, 262 watts. Condenser pressure. You can hear the refrigerant boiling in there. Probably see some mist coming off of it. The humidity in here is insane after the rain we had. So you can, I don't know if you can see that in the video, but there's a, like a fog falling off the bottom. So now, just let it run a while and see how cold it gets, see if it'll frost. If it won't frost, then I'm going to assume I've overcharged it, because I see this line is sweating up here. And, you know, it needs to stabilize before I make a decision. But if there's liquid going back to the compressor dome through that line, it'll cause it not to work right. Rebuilt sticker on it. All right, I'm going to cut for now and come back if and when something happens. So we got a coating of frost forming, and on the bottom down here, you can see the water drops are frozen. That's probably, I don't know, 5 minutes of running. Ice. Motor power. High side pressure. Nice and warm. So yeah, that's a runner. Now, if the cabinet's restorable, that would be kind of nice, but at this point in time, I'm just happy to see the machine working. Going to shut her down, let the pressures equalize, try to get the liquid out of the hoses, get the hoses off, and call the mechanical repair done.